Хорошая идея. Доброе утро всем. Today I will speak English.
Сегодня я буду говорить по-английски, потому что у нас много международных докладчиков.
Hopefully that way it'll be equally accessible for everybody.
И надеюсь тогда, что всем будет доступно. Спасибо всем, кто пришли сегодня, особенно тем, кто только что приехал. Постараюсь немножко ограничиться во времени, потому что сегодня, я уверен, мы перейдем к грани нашей программы. Те из вас, кто только что прибыл, я постараюсь вам объяснить. Вы как десант, который опустился к нам, объясню. Ситуация такая, что сегодняшний и завтрашний день — это сочетание двух разных событий. Первое — это недельный курс, семинар для бывших студентов Московской школы гражданского просвещения. Здесь мы собрались для того, чтобы ознакомиться с общественным дебатом и управлением природных ресурсов. В течение первых двух дней мы много слышали докладов об управлении ресурсами в Норвегии. Это одно из мероприятий, которое продолжается сегодня и завтра. В дополнение к этому, мы также собираемся издать книгу, вклад в которую сделают наши международные докладчики. Это как бы как последствия этого проекта, но у него своя жизнь. Он то есть отдельно своего, в каком-то смысле. То есть у нас такого рода еще книжный воркшоп устраивается, как мы в НУПИ стараемся так эффективно это все сочетать. Естественно, школа гражданского просвещения — это является у нас тоже прекрасной аудиторией для таких обсуждений. Поэтому у нас очень важно, чтобы мы старались придерживаться установленных временных рамок, чтобы и сделать вклад в дискуссию. Некоторые из докладчиков прибыли из далека и, может быть, не совсем еще адаптировались к времени, то есть к смене часовых поясов.
Оба
этих мероприятий, которые мы собираемся совместить, это является часть совместного проекта между школой гражданского просвещения и НУПИ.
Это
трехгодичный проект, финансируемый МИДом Норвегии. Сейчас мы на втором году этого проекта. Мы проводим вот понедельную такую встречу. Была одна в прошлом году, будет еще в будущем году, и в результате, когда проект закончится, будет издана книга. Постараюсь сейчас более академическим образом сделать свою презентацию. И также наш книжный проект в академической литературе. Определить его место. Это, наверное, актуально по трем направлениям литературы академической. Если вспомните политолога Роберт Долс, его концепцию полиархии, многовластия, то есть общество, которое управляется не одним человеком или несколькими людьми, а достаточно разными, может быть, не всем обществом, как в совершенной демократии, но все-таки в которых есть.
We will also be touching quite a lot on institutions. And thus, we are also in a framework that's quite I mean, in a sense, we're within a neo-institutional framework where we believe that institutions are important and the context within which institutions work is important. Although I think what we will be doing goes a little bit beyond much of new institutionalism. And finally, but not least, we are, in a sense, talking about the resource curse, which, as you know, is the challenge of easy money. And as you may be aware, there has been quite a lot of discussion in the literature recently about whether there really is a resource curse. And the different people who do to take a quantitative approach to this have been banging each other over the head with data, showing that there is and there is not a resource curse. Especially this is the Michael Ross versus Haber-Minaldo discussion. My personal view is that some of these studies have limitations, and I am pretty sure that there that being richly endowed with natural resources is a challenge. Not necessarily insuperable, but it is a challenge. And the resource curse and the literature on it has three different versions or aspects. One is the original one, the paradox of plenty, the fact that countries that are rich in resources don't necessarily become rich otherwise. In fact, they're often poorer than countries without those resources. The other is that they tend, and a lot of this literature is focused on Africa, though not exclusively, but they tend often to have more conflict, more violent conflict in their societies. And finally, and most relevantly for our work these 2 days, is the effect on the political system, that countries with resources tend more often, on average, to be less democratic than countries without resources. Now, in the traditional resource literature, one looks, as we did on the previous slide, at the effect of natural resource wealth and its effect on society. So this is the independent variable, and this is the dependent variable. And it's very important to underline that what we are trying to focus on is not that. We're not looking at how resources make you poorer or more authoritarian and so on. We're looking at the, we're switching around the independent and dependent variables, and we're looking at the effect of society on how the natural resource wealth is managed. And this is partly an analytical perspective. We would like to see, we'll see some kind of hypotheses in a moment, if these are true about how this works. It also carries a potential for a more, not just an analytical aspect, but a more proactive or policy relevant aspect, is that if the hypotheses that I have are right, it has some implications for how you should organize society to get as much as possible out of your natural resource wealth. In the literature on the resource curse, there are some, there's very often mentioned some countries which have allegedly escaped the resource curse, which are rich in resources and have, but have still managed to do quite well. And three of the classic examples are Botswana, Canada, and Norway. And often it is pointed out that one of the characteristics of most of these countries is that they are, like Norway and Canada, is that they had quite strong democratic institutions before the resource wealth started coming in. So resources, institutions, according to the literature, are important for how how well a society handles a challenge of natural resource wealth. A challenge, though, when you look out at the world, is that all countries claim to be democratic. This is the parliamentary, it's a parliamentary assembly in North Korea. And as you know, North Korea is called the People's Democratic Republic of Korea. So North Korea is also democratic. In fact, it's more democratic than Norway because Norway is the Kingdom of Norway, officially. Now, of course, we know that, I hope I'm not stepping on any toes, but personally, I don't really think North Korea is a democracy, and I think that's very obvious to most people. But it can be a challenge with many other countries to say exactly how democratic they are. What about, for example, Iran? Is Iran a democracy? In Iran, a group of conservative clergy have a lot of power and are able to control a lot of developments in society. On the other hand, Iran also has quite quite dynamic elections with significant competition, although not anybody can stand for election. And they do change presidents and people lose elections. And it has a dynamic public debate too. And there are many countries like that that have some degree of limitation. You could say maybe every country has, no country has a perfect democracy. So it's all on a continuum. And how do you really distinguish between different institutions in terms of democracy and in our case, especially in terms of institutions which are relevant for management of petroleum resources. So I want to partly define what I think characterizes genuinely working institutions, partly a definition and partly a criterion, you could say, for which countries might be classified as having genuinely well-functioning institutions. And my emphasis is not just on the formal aspect of the institutions, but also on the context. And I think the context for an institution is as important as the formal structure of an institution. And what I want to hypothesize is that permanent and unlimited public discussion driven forwards by a multifaceted society, civil society. So I mean a civil society with many different actors. That's why I call it multifaceted, and many different types of actors. Gives the optimal functioning of institutions for managing natural resources. It gives a diversity of ideas, or first of all, it gives a kind of a multipolarity. So there are different sources of influence on institutions and on decision-making. And it gives a diversity in the ideas which are fed into these institutions. And it also gives provides for checks and balances so that the different poles or actors in society can control each other. And I mean civil society in a broad sense, not just the kind of formal NGOs or quangos and so on, but I mean anybody who contributes to public debate, including political parties, and especially the more political parties, the more you have of that aspect of civil society, experts, government employees, when they talk to the public, journalists, business people, and of course NGOs, and so on. And an important impulse for this agenda on my part came from my base here in Norway, from seeing, this is basically my hypothesis about why Norway has been relatively successful in becoming an exception to the source curse. So yes, it had democratic institutions and a well-functioning government with good governance before the onslaught of, the deluge of oil money. But maybe just those formal institutions and systems are not the only thing. Maybe the general political culture and context for those institutions is just as relevant. And another impulse I got from the Norwegian side is that there is an aid program in Norway called Oil for Development, which has existed for a while now. and which is based on the idea that instead of going and helping people just with humanitarian aid or developing things that we don't know so much about in Norway, we should, in our development aid, we should help other countries with the petroleum sector, which we have a proven track record of in Norway. So oil for development covers 10, 20 countries, it varies, and provides special support for them how to develop good institutions for managing the petroleum sector. And it can be the licensing system, it can be the tax system, it can be petroleum funds, it can be environmental regulations, and so on. And sometimes I've had the impression that that a good bit of the work that Oil for Development does is very much focused on the formal institutions. So they end up going and saying, well, in Norway we have X, Y, Z like this and it's structured like that. And of course you can change it a bit if you want, but basically it should be like that. Okay, try to do that. Good luck. And I think that kind of information is useful, but it leaves out a very important part of the story, which we're maybe not even aware of in Norway, which is how the context for these formal institutions helps them function. And I think there are some incredible opportunities for copying institutions. And in a sense, the China story of the last 35 years, the incredibly impressive story of China, is an example of a communist country taking some quite strong characteristics of its own, the incredible discipline and obedience of the Chinese population and Chinese political culture, the meritocratic aspects of the government system and the staff recruitment, and injecting into this some major and very powerful elements of capitalism, including, for example, stock exchanges, which have been an important driver for growth in China, and free trade is another one. So this has been a huge success story, but I'm a bit unsure whether this kind of copying can be successful in the long run. Maybe China's lucky, and in the Chinese case it works. Maybe not, right? Maybe we're about to see that. If we look more closely turn our gaze to the petroleum sector again, the sovereign wealth fund of Kazakhstan, called Samruk Khazina, is explicitly modeled on the Norwegian one. However, the context, the Kazakhstani context in which it functions, is quite different from the Norwegian one. So the question is, can it actually function as the Norwegian one does, when it has a very different context? That's one important point here. Can you copy when you have a different context, and if the context is important? And another aspect of this, and which is maybe even more important in the long run, is that countries who copy are trying to copy a specific institution or technology, as in the case of this car here, from other countries at a specific stage of development. And I think one of the big challenges of, quite a big weaknesses of the Soviet Union was that it was essentially based on trying to quickly move the whole Soviet space from a slightly less developed level to catch up with Western level, including copying a lot of Western technology. And this was done quite successfully, but always with a delay. So when this was a very fancy new Lada car in the Soviet Union, Western car producers were already producing something else. Now, delay is not such a big problem either. If you're 15 years behind, okay, it doesn't matter so much. But I think the really important lesson here is that it's the strength of Western countries is not the fact that they have certain institutions or technologies or so on, but is that they have an underlying dynamic, interactive, flexible, multipolar system which produces new ones all the time. So anybody copying is partly going to have a time lag problem, but by the time they get there, not only are they late, but the others have moved on and they're going to continue moving on. So copying is a, if you don't have that kind of system, if you don't adopt that kind of system, you're always going to be copying. Back to China, I mean, how much incredible amounts of modern technology are produced in China, including most of the components for Macs and so on. But that technology isn't made in China. I mean, it's not invented in China. It's invented somewhere else. And what China supplies is very cheap, very disciplined, very good labor to do the job. But they don't actually innovate. Another interesting aspect of this kind of learning is whether if you don't have the local context for this kind of institutions, can the global context, in a more globalized world, can it compensate? So Nazarbayev of Kazakhstan, on a few pictures back, may not have a lot of pressure from a lot of different actors in Kazakhstan, but he does have international organizations and NGOs and actors on his back all the time. So in a sense, it's interesting whether the flora at the international level and their increasing ability to make their voices carry into other countries, whether that could compensate for the lack of a domestic public debate. The answer to that, I don't know, but it's an interesting thing to explore, I think, in the context of this book. And the strategy of this book is to have, I've met several books before, but this one I'm trying a new strategy, which is to involve a lot of people, to have a lot of chapters, and to try to get everybody who contributes to the book to help promote it in some way or other. So that's an expectation on you authors. But once you've, it's an additional expectation. Once you've helped have written your chapters, which there are going to be many of, that you all write an op-ed piece or give a little seminar or buy some of the books and send to your contacts or get a journalist to write an article about your important contribution to this book. Anything that can help promote it. And you see the black countries here, we already have chapter authors on, and the gray ones we don't have yet. So we've left the developments for the end, but they will be brought in during the coming months. And in addition, we'll also be bringing in some chapters on international organizations, which also are part of this communication strategy, because these, like Publish What You Pay, has 800 member organizations all over the world. So my hope is that by having somebody from Publish What You Pay, this organization here, write a chapter about their work and how they influence various states in their petroleum resource management, is that they can also help promote the book among their 800 member organizations across the world. Okay, thank you for your attention. If we shouldn't spend too much time, but if there are any important questions, feel free to ask them, especially if the chapter authors have any questions. What is that? What the book is about? You're very welcome if there are any questions. If not, hi, Kenan.
Do I need a mic?
You do.
Thank you. I am Chenan from Azerbaijan. Thank you for this presentation. So my question is about your scheme, about the natural resource wealth and the society. Mm-hmm. What's the place for a position of government in this scheme? You include government as a part of society, or we have to add as an additional, let's say, variable? Because the government is an intermediary institution which translate natural resource wealth to the society, either in the form of curse or bliss, depending on this bad governance and good governance. Thank you.
So I didn't say anything about the government, but you're right. The government is always there, and I guess I'm just assuming that the government is always going. But my focus, I would like our focus to be on, in addition to the government, is anybody else getting to play a role? So definitely the government is important, but important not to just write about what the government did, because that in itself, obviously the government does everything in the end. It's the government who decides, who takes the final decision. So our question is, or we're assuming government is doing the ultimate decision making and so on, but the question is, does the government have a dialogue with other actors or not? Anybody else? No. Okay, very good. I think we will have, this gives us a lot more time for discussion after the very interesting presentations which we are going to have. And they are going to be organized in the following way. We're going to have 1 hour per mini panel, and this hour is divided in two. First is two presentations of 15 minutes each maximum, and then a half an hour for discussion, which everyone is very welcome to contribute to. And first out will be Guillaume Fontaine, who's the head of the Department of Public Affairs at FLASCO, which I see is misspelled here in the program, in Ecuador, but originally from France. And for those of you who don't know Latin America, I believe FLASCO, or I know FLASCO is, or I believe it's a network of institutions, and it's very famous. It's the heavyweights of the institute sector in social sciences in Latin America, not just in Ecuador, but also Brazil and other countries have these institutions. Okay, I hand over to Guillaume. And after Guillaume, we will have Carlo Tognato, who is associate professor at the Department of Sociology at the National University of Colombia. So we start with a bit of Latin rhythm for you. It's okay. First, Guillaume.
Is that, can you hear me? Okay. Good morning, everyone. My name is Guillaume Fontaine. I am a researcher at the Latin American Faculty for Social Sciences, which is commonly misspelled as FLASCO, and should be written as FLASCO. And it's, as Indra said, it's a network of actually international organizations who have a double status, status of a UNESCO organization and a status of a national university. That is, each country, we are 22 agencies, so each country has a specific administrative regime, and we develop our own agenda, but we deliver only postgraduate and doctoral degrees on an international standard. My department is the one of public affairs, and we are currently offering masters in public policies and a doctoral degree in public policy. So I'm here to talk about the paradox of participation in oil nationalism, which is the particularity of Ecuadorian oil sector today, and to try to make some contribution about the incidence of the civil society on the management of this sector in Ecuador, which is changing pretty fast. So, okay. Basically, Ecuador is a 16 million people country. It produces 204 million barrels per year, and last year rent was $3 billion. It's a small producer at the world scale. It's a medium producer at the Latin American scale, and it basically only produces oil and a very tiny part of gas, of natural gas. Compared to the giants up north, like Venezuela and Mexico, or even Brazil, Ecuador is a small player. But it is one of the two countries from the OPEC, with Venezuela, coming from Latin America. Our story, our history of oil exploitation, specifically in the Amazon area, is also a story of many conflicts for contamination and for human rights abuses, specifically in indigenous territories. This has created, like Indra was referring to the context, a very conflictive context and a very particular problem to the role that civil society should play or should not play in oil policies, and specifically in the management of the oil rent. Now, since 2005, we had pretty hard reforms, starting with an episode we'll talk about later, which was the expulsion of Occidental Petroleum from Ecuador, and continuing with the national elections in 2006, huge reforms at the state level, from the constitution to the administrative system, which affected, of course, the management and the oil sector. So my presentation is divided in three parts. I would present these reforms, and particularly what I call the hierarchical governance mode in Ecuador and how it has been settled down for the past 10 years. Then I'll talk a bit more about the policy instruments of the oil nationalism, what I'll call the oil nationalism is precisely the topic I'm talking about. And finally, I tried to make some a short analysis on the relatively limited, and more limited actually, incidence of the civil society on this policy. So the design of the state and the administrative system, which are basically the institutional context of the oil management, of the oil sector management, could be characterized as bureaucratic centralization through multi-annual planning, basically since 2007. Planning has always been an important instrument of policies in Ecuador, but since 2007 it became part of the constitutional framework, and it can be even a reason for the executive to dissolve the assembly if the government considers, and specifically the president considers, that the congressmen oppose or are an obstacle to its implementation. Precisely the constitutional reform, which was made from a constituency assembly in 2007-2008, strengthened the executive power and redefined the role of the legislative powers and the judicial, and created two additional powers, that's the word the Constitution uses, the fourth and the fifth powers. The fourth powers has nothing to do with the media, it's actually the electoral power, it's a kind of agency responsible for supervising and sanctioning eventual frauds on electoral processes. And the fifth power is the one that we're interested in here in this conversation, is called the participative and social control power, and it is supposed to be a kind of a mechanism to fight for corruption and strengthen the control from the civil society over corruption, which is obviously a major feature for the management of the oil sector. Now, as a matter of fact, the legislative power is under control of the executive, not in a structural way, but in a political way. Since 2006, the majority in the National Assembly is the same as the presidential one, which is something that might seem quite obvious for some of you, but it is exceptional in Ecuador since the democratic transition of the early 80s. This hadn't happened actually until 2007. And we had, particularly regarding civil society participation, a strong innovation with the adoption of an organic law on citizen participation in 2010, which is basically the law that gives a possibility to communes and local organizations to call for popular referendums. And it's a very important point because it was precisely ordered by the constitutional reform. It was part of the constitutional reform to create this framework of civil society participation, this institutionalization of participation. Yet, the law on communication in 2013 actually contradicts and fairly regresses towards the past these increasing powers, since it can basically allow the executive to demand or to condemn any kind of actor, private or from media's themselves, for what is called a violation of the constitutional rights. That is, the law is using the constitution to prosecute against any kind of excess, and particularly against the person, the sacrality of the power, and specifically of the executive and of the chief of the state. This has led to some trials lately in the last 5 years, which are actually having huge consequences on the transparency and processes of accountability, particularly on oil problems and rent management. Now, in summary, the reform of the state and the nationalist orientation, I may talk about nationalism a bit in the discussion if somebody is interested in having some more information about that, actually lead to what I call a centralism and a bureaucratic centralism. And this is translated in the petroleum sector by the extreme concentration of power. There are very few people today deciding on the oil policy in Ecuador, namely the coordinating Ministry of Strategic Sectors, which is kind of a vice president, like in the States, the Ministry of Hydrocarbons, which is obviously the ministry, the Agency of Regulation and Control for Hydrocarbons, which is supervising particularly the normative framework, and both national oil companies, Petro Ecuador and Petro Amazonas, I'll talk a little bit about them later, and the Secretary of Hydrocarbons, which is part of the Ministry of Hydrocarbons, responsible for supervising the execution of contracts. Now, in terms of policy instruments, this nationalism is can be analyzed through four big dimensions. Of course, there's a huge emphasis on regulation, like any kind of hierarchical governance mode. Regulation is the main instrument of the policy. And it is it started actually in 2007. In 2006, I'm sorry, there's a small mistake, that's 2006 and 2007, with two executive decrees nationalizing the extraordinary benefits made by private companies and basically multinational companies. There are only one private company in Ecuador, and it's not operating directly in the upstream of the oil sector. So the idea of nationalizing these benefits was to compensate the increase of prices compared to the period when contracts had been negotiated. That it at the mid 90s, the price was around 7.5. Just to quote the referential price is the WTI in Ecuador, which is affected by a penalty of about $15 for the quality of the Ecuadorian crude coming, as I said, from the Amazon region. So these decrees, the first one actually nationalized 50% of these extraordinary profits, and the second one was aiming at nationalizing the 99% of the benefits. What we call extraordinary benefits is the difference between the benefits actually made in at this time, in 2006, 2007, referred to the benefit negotiated, or the margin negotiated in the contract at the 1995 and 1998, which are the 2 years of reference, when prices were so low. And the second change that was made out of the political change and the constitutional change of 2008 was the reform on the law on hydrocarbon in 2010 that basically defines a minimum of 25% rent for the state, even in low prices periods, and actually an average of 50 to 70% of the government take in any kind of contract, that is, from heavy crude oil exploitation to regular contracts or classical contracts of joint venture societies. Below this regulation framework, there's a new organization of the sector. As I mentioned, the main agency responsible from the government is the Coordinating Ministry of Strategic Sectors, which is actually very little accountable to the civil society and very much accountable to the chief of the executive. It's a kind of a super ministry responsible basically of the execution of mega projects, including, for instance, petrochemical complexes and new oil field exploitation, like the one I will talk about later, the ITT. A second particularity of the organization is the separation from the Ministry of Hydrocarbons and the Ministry of Electricity and Renewable Energy, which is particularly bizarre, I'd say, since one of the aims of the multi-annual planning is precisely the transition to non-carbon or non-fossil fuel energy sources and renewable energy, and specifically hydroelectricity, hydropower. And a third element of the reorganization of the oil sector was the modernization of the national oil company, Petroecuador, specifically after the expulsion of Occidental Petroleum in 2006. Oxy had 20% of the production was beyond Oxy responsibility so far, and they made an operation. How much do I have? Five minutes? Is that maximum? Okay, I try to do that. So I'll explain. Yes, I'll try. This way. Adjust it. So you give me 3 seconds more.
You want extra time.
I think it's okay. Can you hear me? Yeah. So I'll talk about Oxy after, when somebody had a question. The third aspect of the reform regards the treasure instrument. That is, first, the elimination of the stabilization funds, and I think it's a major point regarding the comparison with Norway in 2007. Likewise, the elimination of all kind of pre-assignment mechanism in 2008, and specifically part of the national budget that was assigned to oil producing areas, oil producing departments or the provinces of the Amazon. The third aspect, which is kind of the symmetrical to the second one, is the new kind of transfers to local governments, which today perceive 21% of the government's permanent incomes and 10% of the non-permanent incomes. Basically, non-permanent incomes are the oil rent in Ecuador. And altogether, the local governments perceived $3.2 billion in 2014. New aspects, more recent aspects, are the anticipated sellings of oil to China and to Thailand. And I will talk about this later in the final part. And obviously, a major challenge for us is the WTI decrease from $19.8 in 2013 to 2014, to the average today of $52.9 per barrel, which is like a 45% withdrawal of our national rent. Now, the last and not least important part of the reforms regards the management and I would say the control of the information systems. Basically, we are used to having traditional instruments of information such as environmental assessments or any kind of information regarding the management of risk, of environmental risk, and there's nothing very new under the sun regarding this. But the thing is that it is becoming, for the past 3 years, more and more difficult to get access to this information. That is, NGOs or interviewed people told me that they actually do not have access to this information, in spite of this organic law on participation and social control that I was telling about in 2010. Actually, the oil policy is directed by the development plan, and it is called today the good life, the plan for good life. That's the well-being plan, I would say, which is decided by the chief of the executive, decided and approved. And finally, the change of the productive matrix, which is part of the major aims of this plan, is as so far it's not given any precise results, and specifically in terms of energy producing or energy matrix or energy balance, we're still depending, we're still relying on the 97% on oil for our national energy consumption. So in the last 2 minutes I have, I would like to make a little commentary on the limited incidence of the civil society on oil policy, and I would say the more and more limited incidence. First, the heterogeneity of the civil society should not mask that there are actually very few actors from the civil society. As I told, it's a small country. And basically, we have two kind of social movements. The recent ecologist and indigenous movements who emerged in the 90s and had a very important role to play in these reforms. They were actually supporting very highly the actual government until, let's say, the past 2 years. And more traditional social movements, including oil workers and small farmers, specifically in the Amazon area, it's an important point because small farmers have been located and settled down by the state during the 1980s, that is precisely taking advantage of the oil boom in Ecuador. And still, there are deficits of accountability precisely due to the convergence of these sectors, of both kinds of social movements, to the political movement, which is called País, that is in Spanish, Patria Altiva y Soberana. I'll let you translate this. I don't know if our translator speaks Spanish, but I'll let it to the discussion if you want. This convergence, I said, was some kind of absorption movement by the political regime of any kind of social or civil society or social activities. Second, one side effect of the commodity boom of the early 2000s, and specifically when the prices rocketed at $100 per barrel in 2008, which demobilized the civil society and dissuaded most of NGOs to be very pressing on the management of the oil rent. And I think it's a major problem of the book, and I hope we can discuss it now or later in today's dinner. And of course, pre-existing highly centralized institutions called hyper-presidentialism, which is an aspect I will not develop today. And finally, the reform of the state itself, with this hierarchical governance mode, strengthened the political process in as much as it would increase the liability of the state, and specifically the central government, towards the local governments, that is, the relationship at a territorial level, at a local scale, is mediated by local governments more than by the civil society. And at the same time, the disability of many civil initiatives, and specifically ecological NGOs, to exert a kind of any kind of pressure or control on the management of the rent. I will conclude here, saying that deep structural reforms experienced since the 2007 have actually affected negatively the state and the society relationships in favor of a nationalist model of oil rent management. Second, this hierarchical governance mode I was describing earlier was actually at a great cost for horizontal accountability, that is, the division of power between the executive, the legislative, and the judicial. And no need to speak about the fourth and the fifth powers. And finally, we can observe, specifically in the past months, is growing social and political tensions, probably related, I've not made a specific research on that, but there's obviously a lot to say about the decisions of the government to restrain some public spendings. And this is obviously related with the oil price decrease I was talking about in the second part of my presentation. Thank you very much, and forgive my being a bit late.
Okay, thank you, excellent. And then we will go straight over to Carlo. And we have tried to organize these pairs of countries into neighboring countries so that we can kind of get into the context, the regional context a little bit, although we had to make some compromises, but at least now we have neighboring countries. Sorry, so it's on top.
All right, let me activate the tech talking infrastructure. All right. Okay. Well, first of all, I would like to thank Indra for this kind invitation. Actually, I'm very sympathetic with this hypothesis because most of my work has had to do with exporting institutions from market institutions, especially central bank independence, to other countries. And it has had to do with how countries can culturally own their economic institutions. I've got a book titled Central Bank Independence, Culture Codes and Symbolic Performance that came out in New York in 2012 with Greg Macmillan, and talking about China. Palgrave just sold the rights for a Chinese translation of the book. So let me start first with something with a note on theory. As the intro was saying, the focus of much of the literature is on the design of the institutional framework that regulates the oil industry, and his take on it is by emphasizing how society can actually influence decisions on oil regimes, or in general on the way society uses oil and uses the revenues from oil. And the Indra says that that the involvement of a large number of independent actors in the debate ensures a broad and varied base for thinking new institutions, checks and balances on existing institutions, and their continuous dynamic evolution as needs change. In his presentation, in his earlier presentation, he had referred to authors like Rob. What I'm trying to do in this presentation is to move from that view of democracy that got established mostly in the 60s, Badal or Almond and Virba on civic culture, and shift to some later takes on democracy and democratic culture from, for example, Jeff Alexander's The Civil Sphere, or on his work on the civil sphere. I will try to, maybe we might move. Oh, sorry. All right. I will focus on one edge to Indra's story, and I will try to suggest in this presentation, and I definitely try to do so in my paper, that it's not sufficient for the public sphere to be open to a broad spectrum of actors. It's not sufficient to grant them freedom of speech for them to be able to bring up a sufficiently wide-ranging spectrum of issues in public debates. And it is not sufficient to have many different civil society actors actively addressing oil issues in the public sphere. The way, and that will be my take on this edge to Indra's argument, the way a public sphere functions and the rules of engagement of its participants influence the benefits from civil society engagement. So moving from Robert Dahl to Jeff Alexander and Craig Calhoun. Let me give some short pills about oil in the Colombian economy. In 2014, oil made 7% of the national economy. For every dollar decrease in the oil prices, Colombia misses out approximately $40 million. The decrease in the production of oil has recently hit almost 40% of the budget of those departments within Colombia that are most dependent on oil revenue. Over more than a century, Colombia had six oil contract regimes between 1905 and recently. And the evolution of these oil contract regimes has been such that the state take on oil has increased up to 81% with the oil regime that was in place between 1990 and 1994. And since then, since 1998, there has been a decline in state take and on average royalties that have been asked oil companies to pay to the state. In 2010, Colombia designs a new reform of the national royalty system, which centralizes the use of royalties, both on oil and on mining resources, and it gives the central state a greater say on how to spend the money that is received on the basis of the royalty system on a different, on a large spectrum of projects. All right. As far as the involvement of a civil society is concerned, What I did in my paper is to single out some actors that have actually played a rather important role in the public debates about oil. Some of these actors are politicians, not necessarily from the government coalition, but also from opposition parties. Some are academics. There is a trade union, the USO, the big oil trade union, and we will talk about it. There are a few NGOs, mostly on the left part of the political spectrum or far left. There are some media, and I will say something about W Radio, which had which played a particular role in the national debate over fracking, and there are also illegal armed groups, and I will say something about the FARC. Generally, these actors, these civil society actors, have intervened on different kinds of debates. First, the debate over the new royalty system. Second, the debate over the possibility of nationalizing the oil operations and transferring all the operations to the national oil company. And third, there has been a big debate over the international, over the environmental and the social impacts of the oil industry. As far as the first debate on the new national royalty system is concerned, the first politician, Amílcar Acosta, played an important role. He has been a president of the Senate, of the Colombian Senate. He has been, you know, congressman. He has been one of the big experts on the oil industry in Colombia. He comes from the regions of the Caribbean coast. So, in a way, he represents the interests of regional governments over the central government, and he has been minister of mining and energy. And since the introduction of the new national royalty system, he is very adamant to attack it and to criticize it for undermining the constitutional principle of decentralization of the Colombian state. He has essentially said that the new system, by centralizing the management of the royalties, it's creating some administrative bottlenecks that the central state is not able to execute the whole projects that it's supposed to fund with the royalties. And he has criticized the new system for generating at a central level new bureaucracies that are actually not producing the impact that they are supposed to generate. There are some other people, some other politicians on the left side of the political spectrum that have very much criticized this process of centralization of the national royalty system, also because generally in Colombia, the left has little power at the national level, but it manages to command some power at the lower municipal or regional levels. So for them to have a national royalty system that centralizes power, it's in a way, let's say, a measure that undermines their capability of controlling some of these resources. And then there are other actors. Ivan Cepeda is you know, the leader of one of the political organizations that are very much close to FARC. And again, he has been active in trying to criticize the way the oil industry has been impacting on the environment, and he has emphasized the issue of rights to water as a way to counter foreign investors, and as a way to claim that a national industry should replace all these transnational corporations and take control and reclaim the sovereignty over the national resources. There have been academics. This Manuel Rodriguez was a former minister of environment. He is a very well-known environmentalist from Colombia's top elite private university. And he has been very much functional by, you know, talking from a private elite universities, a university. He has been very functional to push the environmental agenda as far as the oil and mining industry is concerned. Uso, the trade union, it's extremely powerful in the oil industry. Its political orientation is on the left or far left. You know, Colombia is a country which has had 6 decades of internal conflict. There is something out there that is the old Leninist tactic of the combinations of forms of struggle. So you got people that are actually moving in a sort of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde fashion between the guerrilla and the civil society organizations. And this is in part something that is happening in the case of this organization. So the way the organization operates is by stressing the need to reclaim sovereignty over national resources. And they are particularly adamant in the nationalization of the oil industry, particularly because their great bastion of power is in the Colombian National Oil Company. And then there are other NGOs on the left and far left of the political spectrum that have been also very active in the public debates over the oil industry, both in the case of the debate over the nationalization of the oil resources and as far as the debate over environmental and social impacts is concerned. Quite interestingly, the very National Oil Association has come out with an op-ed piece in one of the major newspapers claiming that W Radio, which is one of the most important radios in Colombia, played an important role in breaking the backbone of the prospects of fracking in Colombia, because they ran a campaign against fracking, denouncing the effects that he has, especially on the right to water on the part of local populations. And finally, still, Colombia is a negotiating peace accord with the FARC, but it's still at war. It has been at war for over six decades, and the illegal armed groups also play a role in public debates through their official media and through the organization. They are somewhat organic to them. And that recently there has been a gigantic debate in Colombia for the attacks that FARC delivered to the oil infrastructure, especially in the southern part of the country, where it actually affected 160,000 people that suddenly had problems to have access to water. And since that is an area where very poor people get food by fishing, obviously this had a huge impact on their possibility of getting food. And again, the whole debate in Colombia has been focusing on the fact that the oil spills generated or triggered by the illegal armed groups have been much larger than the Exxon Valdez disaster that had been caused by Exxon in Alaska. And there has been some sort of inconsistency between the discourse of the FARC that talks about the rights of people to decent opportunities of living, and on the other hand, it damages their possibility of getting access to water and food. Now, yeah, Bruno Latour is very right about non-human actors, right? They resist. Okay. So the last slide is about zooming into the Colombian public sphere. We have talked very briefly about civil society engagement. I followed Indra's point on the need to have a broad variety of actors intervening into public debates over oil. But what I'm trying to do in this last part of the paper is actually to focus, to zoom into the way the public sphere actually works in Colombia. And I'm trying to emphasize the fact that it's not necessary to guarantee free access of a broad variety of civil society actors. It is necessary also to look at the way the public sphere actually works. In the case of Colombia and what the rules of engagement among the civil society actors are as they participate in public debate in the public sphere. In the case of Colombia, the public sphere tends to function in an extremely partisan way. There are obstacles to applying arguments symmetrically and to apply accountability standards to all participants to public debates, irrespective of their siding on a single issue. And I will say something to clarify a little bit this point. Such partisanship may be a consequence of the extreme political polarization in Colombia, but given the high level of polarization in other Latin American countries, this is something that might apply to the civil sphere in other countries as well. Now, participation in a very polarized civil sphere generally boils down to a commitment ritual by which actors publicly reaffirm their belonging to one or the other camp. So when this is the case, one of the Indra's arguments is that the participation into the public sphere allows a society to discover the possibilities of having institutional arrangements that might be Pareto improvements with respect, or at least institutional improvements with respect to the situation that the country goes through. But the problem is that when the public sphere is very polarized and participation into it boils down to a ritual of simply reaffirming one's own belonging to one camp or another, this kind of discovery function of the civic participation in the public sphere gets lost. So there is something that, in a way, neutralizes the benefits that are being accrued from civil society participation. Public debates at that point lose their character of positive-sum games because they lose this discovery function that comes mostly through processes of public deliberation and degenerates into a zero-sum game whose friend foe logic comes much closer to the game of war than to the game of democracy. Now, in order to clarify my earlier point, I will refer to an article that Leon Teicher published some time ago, exactly with regard to the attacks to the pipelines that FARC carried out in the southern region of the country. And the arguments, Leon's argument is, what if they were multinationals? He complains that civil society organization didn't really intervene into the public debate over the environmental disaster that was produced by the FARC in a very assertive way. And so Leon Teicher says, okay, what if the oil spill had been carried out by multinational corporations? Obviously, these civil society organizations would have been much more active to criticize these actors. So this is one of the problems we currently have in the Colombian civil sphere. Principles like, for example, the defense of the environment are being claimed in the public sphere in a very asymmetric way, depending on which are the actors that these claims might benefit or not. And accountability standards on arguments are also being differentiated according to the actors that are participating into the public sphere. So questions are being made mostly to certain actors than to others. And this is, again, a problem because public debates are not actually managing to produce that kind of public good, which is the discovery of better options that civil society engagement would theoretically produce according to the argument from which we moved. Okay, that's it.
Right. Maybe would you like to stay here? And Guillaume can also join us. And we open for comments and questions. I have one or two myself. Firstly, to... Okay, go ahead. Okay, and when the Russians ask questions, you guys are going to need headphones with interpreting on. Right.
Right. Thanks.
Although I think Martin will be speaking English.
I could try in Danish. I'm actually from Denmark, but live in Dubai.
Yeah.
And we'll do the UAE chapter. But I would like to pick up on exactly where you left, because in reading your sort of prescript to this workshop, I thought much about the relationship between national oil companies and multinationals or international oil companies, mm-hmm. that if that might be a very specific parameter where national oil companies allows much more participation by the public sphere, while if you have strong multinationals like Shell or ExxonMobil, if they are in, maybe you don't have participation in any ways. I think we actually saw that in Denmark, where some of the stock of our national oil company Dong was sold off and so on, and it was all very secretive. So because it's commercial, then you are out of the public sphere.
Mm-hmm.
So. Basically, what is your take on this?
I will kick in. What we have observed in Colombia is that that is not necessarily the case. For example, in the mining and the oil industry, the companies that are the transnational companies that are traded in stock exchange, not the ones that are owned by families or by a very restricted group of stakeholders. Those companies have championed the introduction of social standards in Colombia. And they have been promoted, the use, for example, the RAGI code on business and human rights. And the whole issue of business and human rights, has been pushed by those companies. And local companies have been kind of laggards. So there has been some positive influence through certain channels that have been displayed their influence from the outside, but these channels have not been homogeneous across all the foreign investors that are actually present in the country.
Would you like to add anything, Gil?
Yes, from the Ecuadorian perspective, I guess it's your question.
Mm-hmm.
What strikes me is that there is very little incidence from the civil society on the rent management. As a matter of fact, the only area where the civil society tries to exert some kind of pressure on the political regime regards the environmental and social, in a very, very secondary way, impacts and negative impacts, of course. For instance, there's no political party in Ecuador that would have any kind of proposal on how the rent should be managed. That's very striking, because when we compare with the Norwegian experience, it's absolutely the opposite. And it seems, finally, that the whole expectation of the good way to manage the rent has been translated into some kind of a nationalist discourse from the society, not only from the state, and that is the more the state, the better. So the idea, and it is nothing comparable with the rhetoric of the FARC and the USO and the left wing in Colombia. It is completely different. The concept is that it's much more comparable to Bolivia, for instance, if you want to find a comparison in Latin America. That is, we've been spoiled by multinational companies, and now it's time for us to cover.
Mm-hmm. It's very interesting, because I was actually going to ask you that question. Is that does civil society and the population, maybe they can protest against things, but it's a very different, or it's a very specific role, and limited compared to the possibility of actually suggesting more proactively. So would you say in Colombia that it's the same, that society may protest, for example, this radio station W going against shale, so they can kind of stop, they have kind of a veto right in a sense. But can they actually propose that, well, we should extract more oil or less oil, or we should have,
Well, especially after the introduction of social standards and the whole human rights management systems, impact management systems, etc. There has been an effort on the part of the civil society organization to move beyond naming and shaming to some sort of exercise some positive influence on certain actors. Mm-hmm. And this has happened mostly as a result of the positive influence by international NGOs, like International Alert, for example, and their collaboration on the grounds with the locals. However, currently, also as a product of the very high polarization of the Colombian public sphere, it is very difficult for many civil society organizations to try to have this positive influence because are being stigmatized as sellouts. Mm-hmm. I think that, the way the public sphere works, in a certain sense, is closing the window of opportunity for this kind of...
Which would be, and I guess if Ecuador is leaning in the... Or I mean, is more similar to Bolivia, this sounds a bit like Venezuela, this polarization, and this kind of making it difficult... So it becomes, as you were saying, it becomes a game of war instead of a game of democracy, and the labeling and deciding which side you're on is more important than the real discussion.
Although there are very, I don't know what Guillaume would think, in terms of polarization of the civil sphere, Colombia is not an isolated, or Venezuela is not an isolated case. I would say that Ecuador is polarized. Bolivia is very polarized. Argentina is extremely polarized. Mexico, more or less, let alone the case of Venezuela or Nicaragua. So it's the idea of looking at civil society and looking at the way the public sphere works might be something that might have an application to across Latin America. But I have the feeling it would be very interesting to talk to colleagues from other regions to see what's going on over there.
Yeah, I guess my feeling is that Latin America has this polarization is kind of a Latin American speciality, although it also exists other places. And even in Norway, also they have periods where it's not been so polarized, but it's been slightly polarized. Not over petroleum issues so much, but over, for example, joining the EU or not. It's very kind of a almost difficult to have a discussion. But I was wondering about, we have more questions. I just wanted to follow up Martin's question to make sure I understood it correct. Did you mean to suggest or to ask whether an NOC or government with an NOC would allow more public debate if some of it would be resource nationalist and thus in support of the NOC?
Yes, exactly. Many places in the Middle East, we've seen that they nationalized the oil sector in the 70s. Mm-hmm. And in this way, the politicians got the control of it, right? And they used it to do good for public, for the public, for society, right? And also allowed maybe certain degrees of influence, right? While if you would, on the other hand, have big multinational oil companies, they would be out of the reach of the public sector or the end civil society, because it's just sort of business. You don't interfere with them. Mm-hmm. So I would think more control would be allowed toward the oil sector if it was nationalized than if it was sort of a small national oil company basically letting private international companies do the drilling and whatever.
And again, there was this, from you or from somebody, there was this, I think Carlo maybe added it, about the commercialization, that once it's not national and it's commercial, then you have a whole different dynamic around saying, well, this is secret, or unfortunately we can't reveal certain things.
I mean, in
that
case, that hypothesis is mediated by the way politics and the state work. So depending on how they work or not work and how democracy works, you might get that relation. But there is my sense is that there is a very big variation on that end.
Okay, now we'll... Okay, you were first, I believe. Certainly you were fastest up now.
Тимур Бусаев, Россия, Республика Дагестан. В продолжении темы, которую вы затронули, вопрос может показаться немножко не по теме, но вы поймете, я привяжу его к теме, в принципе, он по теме. Так вот, в августе 2012 года на территории посольства Эквадора в Лондоне было предоставлено политическое убежище Асанду, а в июне 2013 выданы паспорт бывшему работнику ЦРУ Сноудену, да, который потом попал в Россию. Вот. Учитывая, что треть экспорта Эквадора идет в Соединенные Штаты, а четверть всего товара, который въезжает в Эквадор, приходит из Соединенных Штатов, как бы, да, и учитывая, что последний год-полтора цена на нефть очень сильно падает, вот Эквадор дальше будет позволять себе такие политические вольности на внешнеполитической арене? Ну, это, наверное, не только Эквадора касается, а и тех стран, которые рядом и торгуют нефтью.
Well, as a matter of fact, I think Assange is about to leave the embassy. If it was not for such huge pressure from the UK government, in a certain way, he has been used by the Ecuadorian government because, as I was explaining, there is a trend from the former eight years toward a higher control by the state of any kind of information, including the internet. It's not the topic of my paper, so I could not develop that further. But I think it's a basic point talking about the context, and specifically of fundamental rights. So the fact that Assange would be protected, or supposed to be protected, by the Ecuadorian government, actually served as a kind of caution, of moral caution, for a restrictive policy on fundamental rights. I don't know if I made myself clear. Now, speaking about the commercial interest of Ecuador, I think part of the nationalism in Ecuador is precisely based on anti-US discourse and logic. There's an important sector within the government which is still defending, claiming revolutionary principles, and particularly Marxist-Leninist principles of sovereignty and power to the people. So the relationship with the United States has never been as bad as today, at least on the rhetorical perspective. At the end of the day, the United States are still a very important commercial partner. Now, the emerging partner today, and specifically in the oil market, is China. China is today basically is buying 80% of our production, obviously through brokers, so that's not an immediate sale, that's not a spot sale, but it's creating a huge dependency on and a huge disequilibrium on our commercial balance in favor of the Chinese economy, of course.
Okay, thank you. Another one here.
Денис Греков, Алтайский край. Вот вы знаете, у нас достаточно часто сравнивают Россию с Латинской Америкой в области политики. И, ну, как политической системы, так и отдельных каких-то политических решений, которые там принимаются. А вы сравнивали состояние дел вот, в области управления природными ресурсами с тем, как это делается в России? Потому что, ну, вот, судя по тому, что вы рассказываете, параллелей достаточно много, и хотелось бы просто, ну, такое сравнение сделать на самом деле. Вот, хотелось бы знать, что вы об этом думаете.
So, no, I haven't compared it. I think that it might be actually very, very interesting, and also because there are some extreme on the far left. There are some civil society organizations that will need to make a transition from, in certain cases, a Marxist-Leninist view of society to something else. So I guess that on that end, it would be extremely interesting to actually bring the experience of Russia as a comparison. And actually, I'm actually trying to establish channels of exchange on the study of civil society in Latin America and Eastern Europe. As far as the way civil society organization works and the way they might transit from a certain world outlook to another. So I welcome the possibility of future collaborations in that.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
Well, actually, if there is a comparison, it is more... if I compare Korea, which is Ecuador's president, with Putin, I'd say the secret dream of Korea is to be as long-standing a president as Putin has been. And I think for some times, for a while, he was he was dreaming of finding his Medvedev in a certain way. You know, the constitution in most Latin American countries, if not all, prohibit the re-election for more than once to a president. So, in the past 20 years, there has been many reforms, for instance, in Venezuela, and today we are discussing one in Ecuador, to break this rule, to change the rules of the game and to allow presidents to be re-elected in an indefinite way. So there's no need of a Medvedev today in Venezuela. There still is in Ecuador, but the discussion is heading along, and I think the decision by the parliament is already predictable because the majority of 2/3 is the condition is to reform the constitution is a majority of 2/3 of the National Assembly, and the government has this majority today. So it's pushing very hard to have this vote. Early December, at last.
Mm-hmm. Okay, ladies first.
Добрый день. Спасибо большое за ваши доклады. Глининова Ирина, Россия, директор неправительственной экологической организации. У меня такой вопрос. Вот в результате развития нефтяного сектора в ваших странах, да, Колумбии, Эквадора, какие были экологические акции со стороны неправительственных организаций, что в результате этих акций они добились и получили ли желаемый результат от этих экологических акций? Спасибо.
Okay. I will focus on one in particular. Recently, I would say since 2011, 2012, NGOs, especially NGOs on the far left, have recognized that the narrative of resistance against transnational corporations would make it much more difficult for them to command the support of broad segments of the Colombian public. So they started to shift narrative from that kind of reclaiming sovereignty over national resources to defending the right to water. And that has been very effective at expanding the reach of their support among segments of the public, not only the popular but also elite, that are not necessarily ideologically positioned on the far left. They might be liberals and sometimes conservative, but they are who are mobilized by the idea that you should defend the right to water for future generations. And that has been extremely effective, actually, to kick a transnational corporation from Canada, a mining corporation, out of the country. And based on that success, that was somewhat historic, they have increased the kind of emphasis on the right to water, and they've tried to apply it to resistance in the oil sector. And, well, that's one way they have been sharpening up their capability of producing impact in the Colombian public sphere.
Oh, well, thank you for your question. It's a very complex one. Actually, we've published many books on this, not only in Ecuador, but Ecuador may be some kind of a paradigmatic situation for environmental movements in face of the oil sector. I mean, for instance, the international network Oil Watch was built in Ecuador on the Texaco case, on the trial against Texaco, which started at the mid-90s, late century. And this leads to the comment by Indra at the beginning of the debate, and I would like just to make a few quotations here. First, there are actually two ecological movements in Ecuador, and I would say the one is not only an NGO movement; it's a radical ecological movement composed by radical ecologist NGOs, basically urban, based in Quito, the political capital of the country, and indigenous organizations from the Amazon. From the Amazon, because it's the place where negative environmental impacts have been registered for the past 40 years. The majority of the indigenous population in Ecuador actually lives in the Andes, in the mountains. And that marks some kind of frontier between what I would call radical organizations and technocratic organizations. And the radical organizations are basically the one opposed to any kind of extractive activities, not only oil, not only gas, but mining and woods, etc. And they were the most active in the, I guess some of you have heard about that, Yasuni Itete initiative, which was a decision taken by the government in 2007 to not exploit a very important part of the proven reserve, 20% of oil proven reserves of the country, located beneath the National Park Yasuni in the Amazon. You tell me if I speak too quickly? Okay. And that was an amazing proposal coming from an oil-dependent country as Ecuador. And what was the idea? The idea was that if the country would not exploit these reserves, they should expect a contribution by the international community estimated around $4.5 billion, which was that these figures are absolutely science fiction, but they are the one used by the government until 2013. That means 50% of the expected
benefits of the exploitation, of the hypothetical exploitation of the whole reserve. All of this is pure fiction, because you never exploit the whole a whole reserve in any place of the world, and you cannot anticipate it, unfortunately or fortunately maybe, the price of oil, as we know, beyond 2 or 3 years, and that's a very, very, very difficult thing to do.
Or 2 or 3 months.
Or 2 or 3 days, yeah.
Okay. But with your price index?
On an average, yes. No, again, I guess perspective is possible. I think you can predict the price of the oil within the next 3 years, but you cannot say how it would benefit you. Because you cannot evaluate precisely the cost of the exploitation. It depends on so many factors that it's really unrealistic to say that. But anyway, the thing was to propose this non-exploitation in exchange to an international contribution, which did not work. And in 2013, the government withdrew this proposal. And that was a huge political defeat for the ecological movement, because precisely most of the radical and technocratic organizations were involved in that. I would say almost every NGOs and every organizations were involved in this initiative. Each one with a specific agenda, which is something that needs to be discussed further on. And they all went. They all felt deceived and defeated in a certain way by the government. So today, the situation, 2 years after that, the situation is back to a polarized situation, a conflictive relationship between. Well, you could say that technocratic virtually disappeared from the map, from the political map, and the very few radical ecologists subsisting are actually today at a fight of life and death with the government. And I'm talking seriously. Some NGOs have been literally declared illegal for terrorist activities 2 years ago, for their opposition to the oil policy of the actual government. And finally, I think there's something very important to discuss about the role played by national oil companies. And I think it's not only a question of public versus private, or public or national versus multinational. I think if you compare Hocol with Ecopetrol, for instance, you would find many, many differences. If you compare PDVSA or even Petrobras in Brazil with YPFB in Bolivia or PetroEcuador in Ecuador, you would find very different cultures and very different conceptions of the public good, or the public mission, or the public responsibility these companies have. And I think that's something we observe also in Colombia. The national oil company from Ecuador are probably much more responsible of the environmental waste in the past 40 years than the multinational ones. We could discuss on how we can measure that, but there's a lot to say there.
Okay, thank you. We have another question here and another one there. Can we take now 2 questions in one go and try to keep it short? Because I would like to stay a little bit ahead of program, because I'm so sure that we're going to fall behind program later on.
Спасибо за интересную панельную дискуссию. Большуков Сергей, Республика Коми, Россия. У меня вопрос следующий. А вот как соотносится концепция устойчивого развития, о которой так много и постоянно мы говорим с 92 года, и экологические оценки национального развития? Вот для примера, это добыча нефти в национальном парке Ясуни в Эквадоре. Получается, что правительство выбирает в большей степени деньги, а не развитие, а гражданское общество выбирает экологию, а не деньги. Спасибо.
Okay, and then did you understand the question? Right.
And we take one more question, and then.
Да, у меня первый вопрос очень короткий. У нас тут с коллегами вышел небольшой спор. А скажите, пожалуйста, в какой пропорции нефть в Эквадоре потребляется на внутреннем рынке, в какой она идет на экспорт? Это первый вопрос, а второй более объемный. Как национальная нефтяная компания строит модель взаимодействия со СМИ? И какую роль в освещении экологических конфликтов играют гражданские журналисты, а не профессиональные? Спасибо.
Yeah, can we
can you explain what is a civil journalist?
Do you mean freelance journalists?
Это
or alternative media?
Нет, проще говоря, это блогеры, те люди, которые пишут не за деньги от медиа. Ну, то есть, допустим, на них невозможно влиять с помощью того, что редакция получает рекламные контракты, которые пишут, либо создают свои медиа с, как сказать, их контент оплачивают их читатели напрямую, либо делают это вообще бесплатно. Mm-hmm.
I don't know much about bloggers. Okay, the relationship between sustainable development and money. I think the conciseness of your question is precisely the accurate way to make that question. Has the government chosen money? Yes, definitely. And like any kind of government before. And that leads us to another point. It is the urban myth that the today's government is a left wing or progressive or stuff like that, and which was actually the message we had and the international community had until 2013. There's a shift in 2013 that we'll talk about in the article, which means that concretely the question the government asked today is, where's the money? I mean, this pre-assigned sales to China for $5.5 billion, and it's a sale to 15 years, so it's a lot of production, are basically an answer to that. It's the way, we don't want your money, your dirty money from the States, from the World Bank, from the IMF, etc., but we accept money from China. I don't know if I answered you, but basically the objective is the same. Now, the internal market in Ecuador is very small. It's a very tiny one. So 90% of the production actually goes outside. And we do not have a plan to save reserves. We don't have strategic reserves.
You mean of money, of funds, or of oil?
Of oil, of oil.
Right.
I mean, we used to talk about that 10 years ago when we precisely knew that the prices were low and we could precisely take advantage of this low prices situation. Then the prices went so high that it was not question, it was out of question to not to exploit. And I was one of the most critical with the government in the Yasuni-TTIP proposal because I knew this was doomed to fail, precisely because the public spendings increased exactly like in the resource curve thesis. In the same proportion and even a bit more in the latest years as the prices. So the more expensive the oil, the more high the public spending, and specifically for operational wastes, that is increasing the number of civil servants and a small part, let's say 20% of infrastructure. And as for the relation with the media, I don't know how to say it. I mean, it's far beyond the question of oil. It's a question of how governments consider the relationship with the public opinion. And I think it's a lot of problem of political culture and civic culture. But what is observable today is that there is a sector very close to the president willing to extend the control of the state over the media, over the mass media. That was the low on communication I was talking about in my exposure, But today the question is, how can we, the other question, where's the money is the first question, and the other question is, how can we control those who are trying to treason, the verb for treason?
Betray.
To betray, yes. To betray the citizens' revolution. And the first actors to betray this revolution are the journalists. Small one, big ones, any kind of journalist. So I don't know if that answers your question.
I would like just to jump in very quickly on the issue of the first question. So civil society versus government. What we have seen, I think, in Latin America, in many places, is that civil society is split among some radical organizations that are actually genuine about their bet against the extractive industries, and that there are other organizations of civil society on the left and far left. They are anti-extractive when they are not in power and become extremely extractive when left-wing governments get to power. As far as, I give you an example which was recent and pretty suggestive as far as FARC is concerned vis-a-vis its attitude towards the extractive industry. In a region of Colombia, they had a big Chinese company starting to run operations. So they mobilized civil society against the Chinese company. So they blocked operation, they blocked the license. And so the Chinese paid under the counter the FARC. And so FARC started to give signals that civil society should shut up. But civil society didn't shut up. So they had this big problem, coordination problem, that they had unleashed civil society, and they couldn't get the toothpaste back into the tube. So these are the kinds of contradictions that take place on certain ends of the political spectrum in Latin America.
And I guess, okay, sorry. I'll just follow briefly before we have one more question, and that's the last question of this session. I guess the background for the question could maybe have been that in Russia, you have some big national media, national television, which is government-controlled and presents a government perspective. And then you have some independent media, but they are very dependent on financially. So they are vulnerable a little bit to... Well, that was not the background. Do you want to... Vasily, give her a little follow-up, just so we... understand here the real comparison between Russia and the others.
Просто в регионах модель такова, что национальная компания обеспечивает рекламными контрактами все официальные СМИ, и они не могут освещать экологические проблемы, связанные либо с добычей, либо с переработкой нефти. Но так как проблемы, очевидно, существуют, и люди, которые живут в регионах, все равно это видят, потому что когда у тебя во дворе плохо пахнет, тебе не важно, что пишут в газетах. Они начинают искать информацию и находят ее не в крупных СМИ, а находят ее в блогах, находят ее в самостоятельно распространяемых листовках во дворе. Вот мой вопрос был о том, как сами граждане пытаются противостоять вот таким условно зависимым СМИ.
Угу. А они на это ответили уже или нет? So, okay, let me reinterpret again. Is there Russia is a very high-tech society in ways. And for example, I was in Perm, which is a provincial city, when iPad was just released in the US. And still in Norway, you couldn't see it. But in Perm, which is not a very wealthy place or anything like that, there were a lot of iPads everywhere. So in many ways, it's a very digitalized, very technologically advanced society, where people also like to show off what they have. And I guess the question is, and as part of this, and I think we agree on the media situation. So you have the nationally controlled media, you have the commercially dependent media, and then you have like the third force, which is the independent bloggers, some freelance journalists, some NGO activity and so on. So do you have do you have the digital level? Do you have independent bloggers who play some role, who people might go to their websites and have some influence and so on?
When I started my dissertation, I was pretty amazed of the huge amount of information available on the internet, and that was back in the 90s. I was starting that research in 1996, and I had more access from Paris through the internet to information than my colleagues, and specifically my, because I used to be a journalist from Bogota or from Quito. Directly speaking, there was a huge control of the information, not only by the companies, but also by any kind of the state agencies. Today, I would say the situation has worsened in the following sense. First, I think the situation of the press and the alternative media is not very good in these countries, and specifically in Ecuador, it is pretty bad. Bad wages, wrong management, bad conditions of work, and today threats on freedom of expression. So basically, there is no real independence from the companies, either by the media, by the mass media, or by the alternative media. Now, the remaining niche where alternative media are working is, I would not limit it to the blogs, but I think basically all kind of fanzine and bulletins or news circulating on the net. But the problem is that they are very difficult to trust today because there is so much manipulation that you cannot either trust the NGOs. You don't have these kind of big NGOs doing some real stuff in favor of accountability. It's probably much more advanced in Peru, in Mexico, in Brazil, than it is in Ecuador and so far, I would say.
Bloggers in Colombia?
In the case of Colombia, there has been recently, over the past like 3-4 years, an initiative run by a Colombian journalist funds from Ford Foundation to set up an online daily independent that tries to project a kind of ethos of a more sort of independent Anglo-Saxon kind of media.
But how about individual bloggers?
And this has created an umbrella for bloggers that have certain kinds of credential of independence to write on that. But it's a developing process. And in terms of alternative media, I agree with Guillaume, and as they fall under the whole entire situation of polarization and mutual delegitimization that each party's directs to the other. So it's a pretty tough public sphere environment for that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, one last question. And short questions, short answers now.
Okay,
now we want coffee.
Yelena Rukavishnikova, Moscow, Rosneft Company. Well, last summer, the president of Rosneft, Igor Sechin, asked and addressed the official letter to the Ministry of... Well, it's just in English. Sorry for this. Okay. No problems. Yelena Rukavishnikova, Moscow, Rosneft. Last summer, the president of Rosneft, Igor Sechin, addressed the official letter to the Ministry of Economic and asked about the financial support from the state government. It's a huge finance. It's really huge numbers. And it's a little bit strange for the reaction of analysts of Russia. And I'm not ready to be so unpolite and ask you, do you have the same example in Ecuador or Colombia? But I would like to know, do you have any example when the national oil company asked the state government about the financial support or any other preference? What about the reaction of the state government and what about the reaction of the SOSO? Thank you.
A clarifying question. By financial support, you mean...
So, Rosneft, which is one of the world's biggest oil companies, has run into big trouble because of the low oil price and because of sanctions. Specifically targeted at Rosneft. And they asked for, I think, a third of the of the pension fund, the National Sovereign Wealth Fund.
Half of them.
Half of the fund to cover their deficit in 2015. which should, in Norway there would probably be a riot or revolution or something if somebody dared to do that.
In Russia, it's just a scandal of the media, nothing more.
Yeah.
In the case of Colombia, Ecopetrol is traded in the stock exchange. The majority of the share belong to the government, but I don't think they would be able to do something like that, because it would be a breach of competition law, because they would create a situation of inequality between economic actors that are present in the market. So I don't think that could happen. Mm-hmm. And generally, macroeconomic management in Colombia, and I'm talking in the light of the long term, has been pretty conservative. Central bankers, the economists, the National Planning Department, and the economists from the top elite private university in Colombia, a sort of clique. They are very orthodox, so they wouldn't let it pass. Mm-hmm. And that they monopolize macroeconomic management in the country.
Yeah, actually, it's pretty the contrary, because Ecuador has no such problems of corruption, I guess, because it may be explained. I mean, if you look for such a necessity for one company, it's probably a problem of corruption. Although I absolutely I declare myself incompetent on that matter, but the situation of what was the only, and it's today the second oil company in Ecuador, is that of totally dependent on the finance ministry. That is, the financial and administrative autonomy of Petroecuador is totally undermined by the law, 1992 law on hydrocarbon, which specifically obliges the national company to reverse the whole benefits to the state, and then to receive a percentage for their investments. So there's no, it's the reverse. If
the,
I
the state robs the company of its revenue. Right. Okay, we started 16 minutes ahead of schedule. We are now 6 minutes behind schedule. So we're going to have a 10-minute coffee break, which is in the room in there. Sorry about the ongoing refurbishment outside here. And see you in 10 minutes, when we will be talking about Libya and Angola.
Yeah, we still.
Все знак лет? Ике? En to. Fortsette. 1, 2, 1, 2. Jeg hører deg I mikrofonen samtidig som jeg snakker, men du får kanskje ikke ut lyden min nå, og hører jeg masse lyd fra deg, men forhåpentligvis så får ikke du begge deler inn på øret ditt. 1, 2, 1, 2. 1, 2, 1, 2. 1, 2, 1, 2. Nå får du utslag fra den.
Nå får jeg utslag fra den.
Ja.
I det øyeblikket jeg
skrur på den, så får du bare den.
I det øyeblikket, hvis du står og ser på den der nå.
Ja.
Så.
say something? One.
Так, ну, время еще есть. Как я уже говорил, следующая панельная дискуссия – это Ангола и Ливия. И последняя панель – это первая панельная дискуссия была хорошо скомпонована, потому что это были соседние страны. А сейчас у нас будет страна, которая достаточно далеко другого. Сначала будет Ангола. Джесса Овадия, преподаватель школы географии, политики и социологии, перед вами выступит, а потом Ливия.
Так, все слышат, кроме переводчика? Или никто не слышит? Итак, я вам расскажу про гражданское общество Анголы. И что я собираюсь сделать? Я начну с того, что представлю тему и литературу актуальную, научную. И я избрал ряд тем, о которых я считаю важно рассказать, именно из списка возможных игроков арены. Не знаю, как это в результате будет в главе книги выглядит. Я по-прежнему еще думаю о том, как лучше организовать информацию, статьи в главе. Поэтому, если у вас будут комментарии, предложения по этому поводу, я буду рад. Также пытался понять, как лучше инкорпорировать международные НПО, действующие в Анголе, как их включить. Для начала хочу сказать, что мое выступление основывается на моей диссертации, докторской диссертации, которая концентрируется на участников гражданского общества Анголы. Вот так выглядит Ангола, карта страны. Луанда здесь, столица на прибрежье. И в Кабинде, это наверху в правом углу, нефтяная деятельность. Вот у меня, я надеюсь, в октябре выйдет книга, где будет как раз обсуждаться вот ряд вопросов, которые я назову сегодня. Надеюсь, что можно будет... что это удастся. Начну с того, что прокомментирую деятельность Рикардо Шуареса де Оливейра, идея в том, что МПЛА участвует в формировании и ограничении гражданского общества, и они подключили ряд групп, такие как СМИ, организации гражданского общества, профессиональные гильдии, оппозицию и другие пространства заняли гражданского общества. И говоря о гражданском обществе, также существует идея о том, что активизм гражданского общества сдвинулся с позиции реформизма, перешел в позицию конфронтационизма с молодым поколением, которые перешли к новым методам, например, информации и технологии, коммуникационные технологии и демонстрации. Что касается СМИ, то я хочу отметить следующее. Наблюдалось закрытие пространства независимых СМИ, выставление комментариев к правительственной политике относительно нефти сектора. Пока я проводил научные исследования в 2010 году для диссертации, то в июне того же года оказалась такая ситуация, что три крупнейших независимых организации СМИ были перекуплены неизвестной компанией, которая называется Media Investments. Это было три важнейших неправительственных организаций СМИ, которые именно высказываются, критично высказываются по поводу управления нефтяным сектором в стране. Что мы наблюдаем в данное время? Только в Португалии есть критические комментарии против политики Анголы. И поскольку у Анголы есть инвестиции в Португалии, что даже это закрывается, и СМИ закупаются, даже в Португалии оказывается более сложным ознакомиться с критическими комментариями, критикующими правительство. Я также полагаю, что в самой Анголе есть такая проблема, что СМИ в основном действуют из Луанды, из столицы. И большинство людей, с которыми я проводила интервью, они отмечают, что это является проблемой, так как это не отражает взгляды людей, проживающих за пределами столицы страны. И единственный механизм, имеющийся, чтобы достучаться до людей через СМИ вне столицы, это через радио. Национальное радио – это значит, что ты должен выступать на правительственных волнах, радиоволнах. Это единственная возможность вступления в какой-то диалог или дискуссию, используя анголские СМИ. Один профессор поделился, что полностью это происходит затыкание СМИ. Вот это контекст, в котором они действуют. Стоит отметить, как отдельно, то, что Рафаэль Марк, ангольский журналист, который огромную работу проводил по раскрытию определенных вопросов в нефтяном секторе Анголы. Он ряд обвинений, ряд обнаружил случаев коррупции. Это касается компании Cobalt International Energy, американская компания Golden Sachs, которые сделали бизнесом, занимались самыми влиятельными деятелями элиты ангольской. Назаки Oil and Gas. Этот журналист обнаружил ряд чрезмерного использования средств в различных министерствах, и также суверенный нефтяной фонд. По поводу него обнаружилась коррупция, то есть выплата $1 миллиона США компании, которая контролируется сыном президента и тоже управляет этим фондом. Ну, то есть Рафаэль Маркес очень важную работу проделал и подвергся серьезным последствиям этой работы. В мае этого года его обвиняли, перед ним выставили обвинение в Анголе в связи с книгой, которую он в 2011 году издал о, называется «Кровавые бриллианты», против о коррупции и пытках, которые применяются в Анголе. И было все-таки, несмотря, правительство пришло к выводу, что лучше с ним как-то прийти к какому-то договоренному, и гражданский иск отклонили, то есть закрыли, и, ну, несмотря на это ему в результате дали 6 месяцев досрочного, то есть условного наказания, и, ну, после этого он не смог продолжать работать, потому что по-прежнему условное наказание действует, и он рискует новым каким-то обвинением подвергнуться. С точки зрения НПО, когда я делал полевые исследования, проводил исследования в Луанде, я проводил интервью с рядами НПО, и обнаружил, что они идут по такому, должны балансировать. С одной стороны, со стороны высказываться по поводу мнения политики правительства, но не критикуя этого. Особенно в течение последнего года эта ситуация ужесточилась, когда новый закон об НПО, который, я думаю, похож или даже сделан по модели российского закона, который требует, чтобы НПО регистрировались в каких-то правительственных органах и усложняет, значительно усложняет ситуацию НПО в Анголе, то есть продолжать оставаться независимыми или беспристрастными. Это также отбирает у них финансовую независимость, и это тоже создает для них серьезные проблемы. В Анголе есть ряд неправительственных организаций. Одна из них – АДРА. Организация была в 90-м году учреждена. Адра были смогли провести определенную работу относительно бюджета государственного и пытаются повлиять на то, какие средства тратятся на образование, на социальное обеспечение, но при этом и при этом они не угрожают правительству, то есть правительство себя не чувствует под угрозой. При этом их влияние достаточно ограниченное, при том, что представители в Национальной ассамблее еще и не имеют особого влияния, воздействия на бюджет. Министр образования Анголы выступал в Лондоне не так давно, и он заявил на этом выступлении, что он считает, что работа НПО в Анголе положительно влияет на увеличение бюджета Министерства образования. Поэтому возможности существуют для НПО, чтобы влиять на реформы, если они не слишком критично себя ведут, не слишком критично выступают. И норвежский проект «Нефть для развития», она также содействовала этому, так как АДРА – это одна из организаций-партнеров этого проекта норвежского в Анголе, и большая часть работы, которую они осуществляют именно по анализу госбюджета и по увеличению, в направлении увеличения бюджета сферы образования. Когда произошел упад, шок цен на нефть, Ангола, конечно, подверглась этому, и возможно, что если бы у гражданского общества было бы больше возможности как-то включиться или быть услышанными, и если бы больше было средств вкладывалось в образование, то шок нефтяных цен бы не так сильно сказался бы. То есть гражданское общество при том, что правительство тоже осознало зависимость от цен на нефть. PMA, вторая организация, одна из тех важных, которые с гендерной перспективы анализируют бюджет, но у них очень ограниченные возможности это сделать, хотя им помогает ряд других организаций, включая народные помощи Норвегии, но по-прежнему там много остается проблем в этом направлении. И я думаю, что я, наконец, что я прокомментирую, расскажу про вопрос о прозрачности отдельно. В этом наблюдается работа международных НПО, например, публикуйте то, что вы платите, Publish What You Pay, и еще другие организации. Что можно сказать про прозрачность, что местные ангольские НПО, они требует прозрачность не только на правительственном уровне, но и существенная прозрачность. То есть требуется также прозрачность работы международных нефтяных компаний, например. И я думаю, что это очень важно. В этом случае организации гражданского общества Анголы очень сильно себя проявили. Но у них ограниченные средства, ограниченные возможности участвовать в каких-то международных компаниях, например, крупные какие-то компании о прозрачности в Анголе были препятствия, созданные давлением, которому подвергаются отдельные личности, если они каким-то более конфронтационным образом начинают действовать. Также это в денежном, с денежной стороны сказывается, то есть что у них проблемы существовать экономически. Скажу несколько слов о политических партиях в Анголе. В стране не очень много пространства для политических партий, чтобы критично высказываться против действий правительства. Всего лишь пара, несколько из этих политических партий являются реальными какими-то оппонентами или политическими партиями. Есть партии, которые были созданы для того, чтобы создать как бы ощущение, впечатление многопартийной системы, которой на самом деле нету. есть случаи, в которых, которые показывают ограничения политических партий, то есть их ограниченные возможности критиковать деятельность правительства в плане управления ресурсами, нефтяными ресурсами. Был случай, когда в 2014 году, когда хотели провести демонстрации по всей стране, и привлекло это к тому, что пропали некоторые их члены партии. Они пытались легальную мирную демонстрацию и сильно их покарало правительство за это. То есть открыто критиковать правительство не дозволяется. Я скажу несколько слов о децентрализации. Это тоже имеет отношение к природным ресурсам, к управлению природными ресурсами, потому что определенный процент доходов должны, в принципе, перечисляться местным правительством. Я также хочу сказать несколько слов о профсоюзах. Очень ограниченные возможности как-то продвигать радикальные изменения в нефтяной промышленности. Я исследования проводила и в Анголе, и в Нигерии, и я заметила большие различия профсоюзов в Анголе и в Нигерии. В Анголе они не особо отделены от от той партии, которая у власти. И хотя и в принципе они, может быть, могли бы бастовать, например, забастовки устраивать, на практике они этого не могут. Например, что касается передачи трудовой силы как субконтракты каким-то трудовым организациям, в общем, свободы достаточно мало или возможности улучшать стандарты труда. Следующий пункт – религиозные организации. Они достаточно важны, потому что некоторые протестантские, и особенно католические учреждения были инструментом для увеличения прозрачности в нефтяном секторе, опубликования доходов, например, как распределяются доходы. Я это пропущу и скажу немножко о том, что произошло в пространстве относительно отдельных граждан и небольших групп. Наблюдаются значительные репрессии диссидентов на протяжении последних лет, определенных личностей и молодежных групп, которые пытались более как-то конфронтационно выступать, политически протест свой выражать. И это движение, новое движение, которое заменяет в гражданском обществе уже возникшее движение, мы говорим скорее о движении немногих личностей и небольших молодежных групп. Даже Видал в своей работе согласен с тем, что мы говорим о небольшом количестве людей. Но, несмотря на это, реакция от ангольского правительства была такая, что насильственным образом подавлять протестующих. Был отчет от Международной амнистии, издан, о которой говорит о 40 протестах с 2011 года, которые были подавлены, жестоко, насильственно подавлены правительством. Ряд других случаев. Сейчас, в июне в этом году, 18 человек были арестованы. Кажется, 2 недели тому назад их матери пытались протестовать. И тоже жестоко им не дали возможности высказать свое мнение о действиях правительства. Пожалуй, на этом я остановлюсь, и если будут вопросы, я постараюсь ответить. Спасибо большое.
Ну что ж, готовы вы? Готовы. Итак, Ebtissam Эль Килани. Она сооснователь организации «Юристы за соблюдение законов» в Ливии. Сейчас она проживает во Франции, где пишет докторскую диссертацию. Здравствуйте. Итак, зовут меня Ebtissam Эль Килани. Я юристка, сейчас базируюсь во Франции и являюсь соосновательницей организации «Юристы за соблюдение законов». После арабской весны мы решили создать нашу организацию для того, чтобы влиять на юридические процессы и реформы в странах, где произошли революции. Итак, и говоря в общем о нефтяной истории в Ливии, и очень похоже на современную историю Ливии вообще, в том числе, что касается формирования гражданского общества. У нас есть выделяем три этапа. Это этап независимости. Именно в те годы мы обнаружили нефть и газ. Дальше эпоха Каддафи и затем период, который продолжается до сих пор после падения режима Каддафи. Так, как мне менять слайды? И Ливия, как национальное государство, ее социальная структура была в 51 году оформлена в государство, а до этого мы всегда были частью других цивилизаций и государств, очень старых, например, Римская империя, Греческая империя у нас берберская цивилизация, арабская цивилизация. А сейчас, в 51 году, с 51 года мы являемся государством. У нас три региона. Восточный, там больше проживает арабских племен. Это арабы, которые переехали из Ирака, Саудовской Аравии и поселились здесь. Это Серенайка. На юге находится регион, который под влиянием африканских племен. Там тоже есть арабы, но они в меньшинстве. И Триполитания – это регион, где у нас есть и берберы, и арабы, и турки. Конституция. Извините, я говорю про историю, но, конечно, это будет связано с темой выступления. Конституция Ливии разделила государство на три независимых региона. И сразу после достижения независимости Ливия оказалась в зависимости от помощи извне. И у нас были иностранные военные базы, великобританские и британские, французские и американские. Государство сразу захотело, чтобы найти способ дохода. Уже мы знали, что у нас есть залежи нефти, и мы обратились в мы установили комиссию нефтяную, которая должна была разработать нефтяное законодательство впервые в Северной Африке и на Ближнем Востоке. И на сегодня общество у нас характеризуется НПО, которые влияют на формирование государственной политики, которые выступают от имени населяющих страну наций. Итак, с 51 года по конец 60-х мы формировали общество в том виде, в котором оно сейчас находится. Именно тогда формировались академические круги НПО. и представители трех регионов выступали от имени своих племен. И в Циренайке они очень активно выступали с этим вопросом. И сейчас это самый процветающий, самый богатый район Ливии. И местные племена стали проводить переговоры с нефтегазовой или с нефтяной комиссией. Комиссию сформировала ООН вместе с ливийским правительством. Туда входили международные эксперты, в том числе из Ирака, Египта. И комиссия напрямую вела переговоры с племенами, с местными представителями и также с нефтяными компаниями, которые работали в Ливии до достижения независимости страны, например, British Petroleum. И были записаны, то есть они не проводили бурения в то время, они только проводили разведку. И, кроме того, в Циренайке были и представители британских военных властей. И вот такой период у нас был с 51 по где-то 65 год. И все три или все четыре участника этого процесса то есть они как раз заложили основы сегодняшнего гражданского общества. Они были озабочены тем, что иностранные компании имели... То есть они смотрели на международные компании с точки зрения националистов. Нам казалось, что они просто выкачают из нас нефть и деньги. И... Нас занимали вопросы владения нефтью и газом. И еще один очень важный вопрос, который, кстати, привел к изменению конституции, это то, что каждый регион должен получать доход от своих природных ресурсов. И после длительных переговоров между тремя участниками переговоров, в том числе и компаниями, в Триполи проходили эти заседания, в том числе и также в Бенгази. После ряда встреч был оформлен закон, который стал очень важным. Во-первых, он полностью гарантировал суверенитет и собственность государства и народа. И тогда мы были королевством, и король вообще не получал доступа к прибыли от нефти, потому что так было в Саудовской Аравии, в Кувейте, и мы хотели избежать такой участи. Это во-первых. Во-вторых, само государство потребовало, чтобы... иметь возможность конфискации до 40% территории, где обнаружены запасы. То есть нефтяные компании могли начинать буряние на очень льготных условиях. И всего за 500 фунтов стерлингов можно было купить концессию. И ежегодная рента была от 10 до 20 фунтов стерлингов за каждые 100 квадратных километров. И только с 8-го года после обнаружения запасов они начинали платить повышенную ренту. Еще налогообложение государства распространялось только на прибыль после того, как производились вычеты всех расходов. И только 20% роялти было заложено в расчеты на конкурентной рыночной, от конкурентной рыночной цены. И в то время ожидалось, что в Ливии не будет таких больших запасов, гораздо меньше, чем у Египта, Туниса и Алжира. Кроме того, контракты заключались не более чем на 50 лет, кроме исключительных случаев. И сразу после того, как был принят закон, государство установило, учредило нефтяную комиссию. Потом она была впоследствии заменена национальной нефтяной компанией, но сначала была создана комиссия, и первая концессия, по-моему, была выдана в 58-м или 59-м году, а первые запасы подтверждены в 61-м. Из 63-го года, и, кстати, закон остается в силе, тот же самый, с 55-го года и до сегодняшнего дня он имеет ту же самую юридическую структуру, но сначала закон сначала предусматривал соглашение о концессиях. До 70-х годов государство у нас выдавало концессии по определенным юридическим процедурам иностранным компаниям, и участники гражданского общества или их представители, то есть представители племен, местных сообществ, получали доходы, то есть региональные правительства получали доходы, они могли развивать инфраструктуру своих регионов. К сожалению, сначала у нас был очень успешный опыт, но нужно было продолжать развивать эту систему. Мы вообще в то время не поднимали вопросы о охране окружающей среды. Никто не задумывался над правами человека. То есть это просто не выносилось на повестку дня. И дальше началась эпоха под Каддафи. Очень длинный, очень скучный период. Здесь вы видите наши месторождения нефти. Как вы видите, в основном они расположены на востоке, несколько на западе и на юге страны. Итак, Каддафи в 69-м году пришел к власти. И он испытывал влияние международных и национальных идей. Он думал о судьбах арабского мира, он думал о том, чтобы страна стала членом ОПЕКа. То есть все, что он учредил, он называл революционным, у него был революционный совет, который он возглавлял, и этот совет был и законодательной, и исполнительной властью в стране. И он очень быстро национализировал все нефтяные компании, в том числе иностранные, все банки, все школы, все учреждения стали государствами, и все инструменты гражданского общества, то есть СМИ, учебные заведения, независимые учреждения, все они стали подчиняться революционному комитету. И все остальное начало преследоваться по закону в судебном порядке. И после национализации, после того, как он стал заключать соглашение о партнерстве после национализации. Конечно, все это было хорошо организовано, структура была хорошо. Законы остались вроде бы теми же, но соглашения о разделе имущества, извините, о разделе продукции стали заключаться, и доходы поступали сразу в Центробанк и больше уже не возвращались ни в каком виде в национальную нефтяную компанию. И революционный комитет забирал до 60% доходов от нефти и газа, а у нас не было других источников дохода у страны. И были учреждены несколько фондов инвестиционных для... И 60% доходов ливийского государства в течение 40 лет просто исчезало где-то. И никакого развития 42 года не велось ни в экономике, ни в политике, ни в социальной сфере. Итак, 42 года – это был самый длительный период ливийской истории. Далее, мне не нравится слово «революция», но, скажем, произошло восстание. Режим Каддафи был сброшен в 2011 года. И режим, надо сказать... Первый независимый режим был установлен в Циранайке, потому что Каддафи он все перенес с востока на запад. То есть запад всегда чувствовал, что они самый богатый регион, вся нефть у нас, вся социальная инфраструктура у нас. Но все у нас было централизовано на Западе. И революция началась на Циренайке. Но стали сразу звучать призывы больше независимости. Что касается Триполи, после того, как Каддафи был убит, мы очень быстро... вернулись к этапу, который у нас был еще до независимости. И, конечно, первый этап этого периода характеризуется большой активностью, большим количеством НПО. Мы пытались... НПО открывались в большом количестве, их было сотни, была проведена юридическая реформа. И, конечно, мы думали об управлении нефтяными доходами, но, кроме того, было еще две силы в стране. Это политические партии. К сожалению, у них были другие повестки дня, они большинство из них регионального значения. В Триполи стали сразу открылись партии арабских или мусульманских братьев и других партий такого толка. Они называют себя независимые, но кроме того, партии были у разных племен этнических, и в начале был такой мягкий период. Хорошо прошли первые выборы, но затем национальный конгресс оказался под... Там большинство было у партии мусульманские партии, братья, и милиция полностью парализовала месторождение на побережье. И страна ведь зависит только от замороженных активов, которые за границей. у нас было 2 миллиона баррелей в сутки, до 830 баррелей в сутки упала производство добычи нефти, и у нас страна, извините, теперь разделилась на восточную часть, где Бенгази, где есть определенная независимость от Триполи, а в Триполи царит мусульманская милиция. Большое спасибо. Вот мне очень было интересно, как вы будете говорить о Ливии в общем, потому что это такая огромная тема, сложная. Итак, у нас есть немножко времени до обеда. Пожалуйста, Марк. Спасибо за презентацию. Я Марк Томпсон из Саудовской Аравии. У меня на самом деле про Анголу вопрос. Я в ваших слайдах прочитала кое-что интересное. Вы сказали, что в 13-14 годах государство у вас запретило ислам и закрыло мечети. А на каком основании? Какой процент населения в Анголе мусульмане? Просто мне интересно, какая на сегодняшний день политика в этом вопросе? Да, я как раз хотел сказать, что мусульманское население составляет 90 тысяч человек. В Анголе много религиозных организаций, в которых членство от 100 тысяч и выше. То есть можно закрыть организацию на том основании, что она малочисленна. И, конечно, это привлекло внимание во всем мире, но они просто хотят иметь контроль и влияние в абсолютно всех сферах. Они не пытаются бороться с экстремизмом или что-то такое. Они просто хотят контролировать все пространство, куда может проникнуть гражданская активность. Эбрахим Эль-Манаси из Калифорнии. Когда вы говорили о исламском государстве, мне интересно, есть ли примеры, как в Ираке, исламское государство пыталось взять под контроль вашу нефть? Конечно, можно мне обратно увидеть слайд? Посмотрите на эту карту. Большинство месторождений у нас на востоке страны, в Курдистане, рядом с Ираком. И милиция мусульманская поддерживает, кажется, через год после восстание, они взяли под контроль вот эти месторождения, они стали требовать, эта провинция стала требовать независимости в большей степени, и на сегодняшний день исламское государство взяло под контроль город Сирна. Это как раз на границе Востока и Запада. Они так много раз после 2011 года пытались взять его под контроль. И, к сожалению, вот эта территория контролируется исламским государством. Это территория, на этой территории радикалов исламского государства меньше, ИГИЛа. И в этой части страны меньше. А дело в том, что государственные службы, они все на востоке, на западе, извините, и восток у нас парализован.
Можно? Yes. Георгий Чижов. У меня вопрос к госпоже докладчику по Ливии. Вы назвали период Муаммара Каддафи скучным и несодержательным с точки зрения развития государства. Тем не менее, в мире иногда говорят об оригинальной концепции распределения природной ренты в интересах населения, которую установил Каддафи. Это концепция акционерного общества, акционерами которого являлись якобы все граждане Ливии. И все они получали свой профит, который, опять-таки, якобы позволял им поддерживать высокий уровень жизни при общей неразвитости инфраструктуры и гражданского общества. Можете ли вы прокомментировать, я понимаю, это очень сложно сделать коротко, в двух словах, но все-таки как работала эта модель и как реально жили граждане Ливии при Каддафи с точки зрения получения профита от природных ресурсов? Спасибо.
Спасибо за такой вопрос. На самом деле я не называла это скучным. Это было на самом деле очень интересно. Но у меня же, я же юрист, у меня нет политических взглядов. Я не пытаюсь критиковать Каддафи. Я хочу сказать, что у него были прекрасные идеи. И он действительно их применял на практике, и он национализировал весь нефтяной сектор, он промотировал новый порядок экономический, международный, и хотел, чтобы это все шло на благо народа. Он учредил несколько фондов, где люди якобы могли участвовать. На самом деле его племянники и сыновья управляли этими фондами. И Ливия была абсолютно коммунистической страной, кроме последних 5-6 лет, когда экономика чуть-чуть приоткрылась. И средняя зарплата ливийца, университетского профессора, доктора... У нас же не было вообще частного сектора. Примерно $350. И для нефтяной державы с населением 3 миллиона, которая добывает 2 миллиона баррелей в день, $350 в месяц, но это не позволяло людям ездить, путешествовать или даже невозможно было получить медицинское обслуживание. Медицинское обслуживание было очень примитивным, и он не смог эту идею реализовать.
Так, еще вопрос. И потом я тоже хотела бы задать
вопрос с обоим докладчиком. Скажите, пожалуйста, вот изменения в законодательстве, которые контролировали, с одной стороны, участие иностранцев в нефтяной промышленности, а с другой стороны, влияние иностранного капитала в других сферах, ну, то есть там, не знаю, в медиа, в социальной, развивались ли они однонаправленно, или можно сказать, что экономическое регулирование и там условно социальное регулирование иностранного капитала было неравномерным. Спасибо.
Не совсем поняла вопрос, извините.
Условно говоря, были одновременно ли вводились ограничения, например, на участие иностранных инвесторов в нефтяных разработках и, допустим, ограничения, не знаю, уставной доли капитала иностранных компаний в национальных медиа, для примера?
So restrictions on foreign capital capitals. In oil and in the media, СМИ, introduced at the same time.
То есть было ли это в одно и то же время? Если мы говорим о тех изменениях, которые произошли до или после времени Гаддафи, то Гаддафи он не ограничивал капитал компаний, которые занимались поисково-разведочными работами, добычей, но как компании, которые, когда национализировали, они были приглашены в 80-е годы, но уже при других условиях. То есть государство больше участвовало в управлении, больше участвовало даже в... Иностранный капитал, он там был, просто государство было больше власти в управлении, потому что у государства не было способности самому проводить свои деятельности, добычу. Это относительно нефти и газа. Что Гаддафи, он отделил сектор нефти и газа от других секторов. До этого не было иностранных инвесторов в Ливии, не было никаких иностранных школ в Ливии, даже иностранные языки. Даже берберы, например, и амазии, им было запрещено говорить на своем языке. Это касалось только нефти и газа. Что касается других секторов, даже СМИ, то отсутствовали полностью иностранные и какие-то частные, даже национальные участники во всех уровнях экономики и социальной. Это при Гаддафи 32 года. После этого, да, сразу же партнерство заключено было с иностранцами, НПО. Сейчас, может быть, существует 200 или более телеканалов, радио. Все они частные и все... То есть это параллельно с гражданской войной, которая происходит в стране. Есть участие иностранных и ливийцев в частном секторе. Стало было намного более активным и... Нету никаких ограничений ни иностранного или национального участия. Я думаю, что в плане Анголы это актуально, потому что я в своей презентации не говорила особо про историю страны, но что я сейчас говорю, что, конечно, Ангола претерпела гражданскую войну с 60-х годов, которая длилась до 2002 года, и в этот период это полностью иностранные компании контролировали добычу нефти. В Анголе эти фонды, это то, что позволяло правительству участвовать в гражданской войне до 92 года, когда правительство было марксистско-ленинистским, тогда не было никакого пространства для независимого гражданского общества, СМИ независимых. И поэтому различия границы проходят там, где, когда частные компании американские получали права на добычу нефти, но не было свободы в гражданском обществе. А после 2002 года это коротко было, открыли возможности, и появилось некоторое пространство для гражданского общества, но то, что последние годы, и мы опять наблюдаем, опять закрытие этого пространства. Не знаю, ответил ли я на ваш вопрос. У нас уже время начинает истекать.
And short replies, and let's take one question from you. And
давайте от вас один вопрос выслушаем, и у меня будет вопрос.
Все, что вы рассказали, очень интересно. Ну, вот вы знаете, хотелось бы уточнить один момент. Вот мы сейчас весь разговор уже много дней выстраиваем в рамках теории о ресурсном проклятии. Как бы вы в рамках вот этой теории рассуждали о проблеме нефти вот в своих странах и тех событий, которые произошли и происходят сейчас вот в связи с этой проблематикой? Насколько, вот как вам кажется, в ваших странах оправдывается или не оправдывается эта теория?
So basically, do you have the resource curse in your countries? Do you consider that's one of the problems?
Ну, то есть, есть ли у вас проклятие ресурсов или нет, иными словами, в ваших странах? И я бы хотела задать вопрос Джесси. Так как коллеги собрали правительственные документы правительства в ряде стран на протяжении долгих лет. И то, что мы обнаружили, изучая эти документы, некоторые страны, таких как Канада, Норвегия, Швеция, есть эффективная цифровая база данных онлайн, тысячи документов, которые можно быстро найти нужный документ. А другие страны, у них поменьше таких документов. А есть тоже документы, у которых вообще отсутствуют такого рода документы, которые не публикуют никакого политического курса правительственного. Правительственный информационный документ. Есть ли у Анголы возможность даже как-то справляться со своими ценностями нефтяными, или настолько это слабое? Я никогда не был в Анголе, но или государство настолько слабое, что даже не в состоянии прислушаться к гражданскому обществу, если оно хочет о чем-то заявить? По поводу проклятия ресурсов, мои исследования в основном касались о разных вариантах политики, путей, по которым Ангола могла бы побороть именно проклятие ресурсов. Поэтому, как Индра говорил раньше, я думаю, что в наилучшем случае можно относиться к проклятию ресурсов как к какому-то вероятному пути развития при надлежащем курсе политики, который можно было бы какой-то противовес найти ему. Но я думаю, что Ангола по-прежнему является наилучшим примером именно проклятия ресурсов. Это история гражданских войн и очень распространенной коррупции. Я думаю, что Ангола и Нигерия – это те страны, о которых прежде всего подразумеваются, когда мы говорим о проклятии ресурсов. Но я хочу сказать, что должны иметься другие варианты. Это не единственный путь развития. На вопрос Индры, как Рикардо Шварес говорил, что Ангола, которая успешно не преуспела. С одной стороны, она функционирует очень эффективно. В этом смысле Ангола в состоянии была хорошо руководить, управлять ресурсами и контакты с международными компаниями создавать. Но у страны есть возможность анализировать ситуацию на международном уровне, вести переговоры с различными игроками. Я как научное исследование, это, конечно, для гражданского общества очень неблагоприятно то, что закрытая очень система, так как скорее очень много неофициального происходит каких-то дебатов или закрытость информации. Во многих случаях, если получается как бы расколоть эту систему или получить доступ к определенным лицам, тогда можно получше разобраться в том, что происходит. Но есть высокая степень закрытости, это проблема тоже для гражданского общества, так как они таким образом лишаются возможности участвовать в этих диалогах. Спасибо. А вы как считаете, связана ли проблема Ливии с проклятием ресурсов? Если честно, то я думаю, да. Ливия является очень хорошим примером проклятия природных ресурсов, потому что, когда вы раньше сегодня объяснили, что страны, которые не подвержены этому проклятию, как Норвегия, Канада, вы говорили, что что демократия уже существовала до того, как нефть и газ были обнаружены, в то время как в Ливии, к сожалению, государство было создано как раз на момент обнаружения этих ресурсов. И И тогда все международное внимание было направлено только на это и больше ни на что. И коррупция началась 15 лет после обнаружения этих залежей. И вся история государства по сегодняшний день, то есть конфликты по-прежнему связаны с этой промышленностью. Поэтому мы не можем сравнить с какими-то другими аспектами, за исключением обнаружения этого ресурса в 50-е годы и коррупции, которая началась в конце 60-х годов и продолжается, и передается, переросла в гражданскую войну в данное время. Гражданскую войну, к сожалению, ответ на этот вопрос – да. Хорошо, спасибо большое. Сейчас у нас перерыв на обед до 2 часов. Пожалуйста, вернитесь к 2 часам. А те из вас, кто